I believe that Gandhi's views were the most enlightened of all the political men in our time. We should strive to do things in his spirit, not to use violence in fighting for our cause, but by non-participation in anything you believe is evil.
These are powerful forces we're up against, but not to resist is to succumb to despair, and we can't succumb to despair. Because that's what they want us to.
As long as you always say, the chance will never come, nothing will happen.
For the first time in my life that I can remember, people are standing up to the government, yep. Standing up to the federal bank in a giant way.
Huge.
I've never seen this before.
This is really where the hope of America lies. And all of the efforts of intimidation that we've seen by the police in New York, the disproportionate amount of force and the disproportionate numbers that have been deployed to contain the protests here, for me, illustrate that the real people who are scared are the power elite. Of course, they're trying to make you scared and us scared. But I can tell you, having been a reporter for the New York Times, that on the inside, they're very, very frightened. They do not want movements like this to grow.
You let one ant stand up to us, then they all might stand up. Those puny little ants outnumber us 100 to 1. And if they ever figure that out, there goes our way of life.
What they want is for us to remain passive, and to remain frightened. And as long as we remain passive and frightened, entranced with their electronic hallucinations, we are not a threat. The moment people come out and do this, the corporate state is terrified. And if you doubt me, look around you at the huge numbers of cops, and not only that, but the kind of brutality that the cops have visited on peaceful protesters. Fear is a potent force, and the security state and the corporate state has worked overtime to make us afraid. Because when you're afraid, you think with a different part of our brain. You become politically, emotionally, intellectually, and even physically disempowered. And we have to stop being afraid. And if we stop being afraid, then these nefarious forces that are destroying our ecosystem and destroying our country, their fragility will be exposed.
What is this going to accomplish? That's the real question. That's why it's so exciting to me, because this is a period of uncertainty. You know, it's really obvious that people are pissed off. It's really obvious that the cat is out of the bag. Everyone knows this is a corrupt system. It's horribly, horribly corrupt. The Congress is corrupt. Congress is bought and paid for. The president is bought and paid for. Everyone's bought and paid for it.
I think the way to overcome fear is to break the kind of atomization or isolation that is inherent within American society. That when you're, for instance, sitting in a park like this with a group, or you know, when I go down to Washington with Veterans for Peace, there is a kind of communal, even religious quality to those kinds of protests that are deeply empowering. It's that ability to endure situations that are frightening and know that there's somebody standing next to you. And that's why, again, acts of civil disobedience are so important.
Ladies and gentlemen, there is more to your life than obeying the government and shopping. You are a human being. Your life has value. Stop paying your taxes to the government to give to the bankers.
We ought to treat each other decently. That was the teaching of the Christian Church. I think there's more Christianity on the steps of St. Paul's than there may be inside St. Paul's. So we are really saying again what people have said for many hundreds of years, love your neighbor as yourself. That is what we are about.
Thank you.